The following is a conversation with Professor Barry Brown of Stockholm University. This was recorded to supplement our teaching at the Interaction Design Master's Program, part of the Joint Department of Computer Science and Engineering of Chalmers University of Technology and University of Gothenburg. Barry Brown has degrees in computer science and social sciences, and a lot of his work takes place at the intersection of those two disciplines. He's produced more than 100 research publications on the design and usage of digital technologies, in addition to his experiences in creating these applications for commercial purposes. The subject of mobile computing, which we also teach, figures prominently in his research, where he uses qualitative approaches to uncover the nuances of how we live, work, and move with technology. If you find these conversations useful, then subscribe to this channel and follow me on Twitter at Dr. Baitash, where I continue to cover topics in design, innovation, computer science, and more.
Welcome to the show. Where do we find you today?
I'm in sunny Stockholm.
Stockholm is so nice. Beautiful. Really good coffee, too. It's hard to find bad coffee in Stockholm.
I do try, actually. I quite like weak coffee. It's quite hard to find, actually, because people like their coffee strong here, but I'm one of these, I guess I lived in America for a while, so I quite like weak coffee.
For our audience members who might not be readily familiar with yourself and your work, would you care to introduce yourself shortly?
So, I'm a professor at Stockholm University, and my focus is in sort of understanding and designing different technologies. So my background, basically, I was kind of trained as a computer scientist. And then when I came out, I worked at a big bank called JP Morgan. When I was working at that bank, I was a kind of programmer, worked as a programmer. And I worked at this bank, and I kind of realized that the things that were really important about whether stuff went right or wrong was rarely the programming. And it was a whole bunch of stuff to do with the organization and the setting and what the systems did. And so I got more and more interested in the sort of social side of the things. And so I went back to university and did a PhD in sociology, looking at how people collaborated in different workplaces using computers. And then through a few hops and skips, I worked a little bit in industry at Hewlett-Packard and Microsoft. And I also taught a little bit in the US, in University of California, San Diego. And then about just under 10 years ago, I moved to Stockholm.
I'm talking to you today, interviewing you in the context of a course that we're teaching at Chalmers University, which is mobile computing. And I noticed that your work as an academic seems to cover a broad understanding of mobility and mobile computing. You've studied like commuting and tourism, driving, traffic, maps, scooters, bikes, and online courses, all in the context of computing and design and social sciences. So what would be your operating definition of mobile computing when you do this work?
There was a time when it was really simple, wasn't it? Where there was computers that didn't move and there was computers that moved. And you could sort of say, well, that's mobile computing because it's moving. But then, just the nature of technology, it gets smaller, gets more energy efficient. So it gets packed into these smaller and smaller places. So just about any technology is mobile now. And of course, with the kind of, with networks, wireless networks in different ways, we rely upon cloud services in the sort of systems that we use. So even if something is mobile, it can, most of the actual work can be happening in the cloud somewhere else. So it used to be quite a simple thing to divide apart. But nowadays, I think, and in my work anyway, I sort of tend to say, don't think about the device anymore. It's not that the device is mobile, it's that being mobile is part of how it's used. So to give you an example, in all sorts of cities around the world, these like little electric scooters have got popular lately. And those having them, a board, and a kind of a network board and a little processor, and they basically can tell the company where they are all the time and deal with being activated so you can pay to ride them around. And that's a really kind of good example there, because it's the the scooter, obviously, that's mobile. And actually, the people who made those boards, for years, they really struggled to get people to use them because people weren't thinking the right way about what you could do if you actually truly made the system mobile.
How would you give us the state of play, the state of art in your field? What's going on today in your field and where is it headed?
We're kind of really dealing with trying to not just think of the new things that systems can do and not just focus on that, but also trying to understand some of the problems that systems kind of provide. So I think we're all kind of aware of the fact that things like social media, they can be a bit problematic as well. And things like mobile games. I mean, now we all like playing different mobile games, but there can be some problems as well with them. So I think that's one of the kind of things I think that's happened in the last couple of years has been this move to being a little bit more, not just sort of thinking up all the amazing new things that we can do, but also actually being a bit more critical and reflective on what's going on.
When you say being reflective, are there any specific questions or specific ways of investigation that implies?
Focusing on the user, that's always been kind of the way that I kind of cut into these things. And I really try and understand the world through their eyes. So that's just the kind of first step I always kind of do. So if we take something like mobile gaming, I think it's really important to understand sometimes. So there's been a kind of interesting thing lately is that mobile games have started to focus on shorter and shorter sessions of use. And one of the reasons why that is that people just don't have much time. If you're like, say you've got two kids, you've got a job that you've got to get to, you might have just be stuck in a queue at a shop to buy something. You're in the situation where you might only have a very small little bit of time to play something. And if you look at most video games, if you've got 7 seconds to play them, you can't even get into the game in 7 seconds. So there's been this move, I think, with a lot of gaming that they've gone for this like much more shorter time. And that comes from understanding the position and the situation of the user as much as possible. And if you do that, then I think you actually kind of can listen to what people say the problems are themselves. Because people themselves will tell you, I spend too much money on this, I've bought this game and it's rubbish, I can't get my money back, or the common one is like kids get their parents' devices and they buy lots of virtual currency. So people themselves, I think, are very reflective on those problems, and not to come along and think that the researcher knows everything. It's like just listening to what people tell you themselves.
I'd like to ask you about how to actually design with this kind of perspective. What I mean is most commercial interaction design, it's concerned with designing for screens, which is in this day and age fairly straightforward. There's really good tools and processes that are very widely used, adopted, and well understood. People use wireframes, for example, various flavors of usability testing. There's lots of prototyping tools. I'm imagining that when you adopt such a comprehensive outlook, such a broad understanding of technology and such a focus on the user, that would unlock a lot of invention and diversity and value. But then maybe the conventional design tools for focusing on designing for screens, they might not be sufficient to capture those opportunities or to address those concerns. So how should designers deal with this kind of broadening of scope? What kinds of approaches or methods are you advocating for designers to adopt?
I mean, screens are important, right? Like, you won't have me saying that you don't have to make you know good interfaces. But of course, it's always just that crucial thing about, you know, what situating the app and what the life of the user, right? So I always give this example of Hipstamatic. They were one of the early iPhone developers, and they had great success because they created this really nice kind of filter for photographs, and it was really popular. I don't know if anybody, your viewers, had used Hipstamatic, but it was a great app, and it was one of the kind of big early successes. And they made kind of a bunch of money, and they kind of came out with a whole new filters, and it was a big thing for a while. But we haven't heard of Hipsomatic for a while. And why is that? Well, because another company came along, and the company was called Instagram. And what Instagram added is they remembered this really important thing about photographs, about the Kodak moment, as they used to call it, which is that photographs are about sharing. They're about showing someone else your picture. And Instagram did the most simple thing ever. They just had this scrolling feed of photographs that other people had taken that you could subscribe to. And on the base of that simple functionality, they built a huge industry. And that innovation wasn't in the interface. It wasn't they built a better interface. They could have knocked their head against wireframes forever at Hipstamatic. They would never have done that. What happened is the Instagram versus Hipstamatic made that kind of move in understanding what photographs were for people. So if you're designing anything from a bike app to a food ordering app, it's you can build great interfaces, but it's understanding where that interface is in people's lives and the frictions that you get that can be caused if you don't fit with that life in the right way.
To capture these kinds of insights that you're talking about users and the context and the tasks and their habits, I am quite a big fan of doing qualitative research, which is like observations and interviews and participation sometimes in the research and some other methods. And you also seem to be a champion and master of qualitative research from looking at your work. So I would like to tap into your wisdom a bit on that topic. I see that a lot of resources on qualitative research especially for design and computing, they cover how it should be done in the moment. They tell you what to do when you go and you are in there face-to-face with your user, you're interviewing or observing. And there's also plenty of examples in research papers where we see how these results are reported. So we see the final product. Where I observe my students and also sometimes myself stumble is between those two things. So when you're doing qualitative research, what are some intermediate steps, documents or deliverables that you produce between the time that you go and do the research, collect the data, and then you report it? And where can we find examples of these?
Maybe tell you a little bit of story about qualitative and quantitative methods first, because I think it's fun really, because you know, when we've got a technical background, and I had a technical background, it's so easy to really be impressed by quantitative work. And I've worked in companies, and this is all the time, it's just much more, and it feels much more solid and compelling when you've got kind of quantitative results. Two little things that are there. So that I had a friend who was an economist, and he was field worker, and he was going around administering kind of questions on people's financial planning in different parts of the world. And one of the questions that he had in this questionnaire that he had to ask people was, would you like to have one car today or two cars in a year's time? And it's meant to test how much do you value your current financial situation to your later financial situation. And he said he was talking to somebody, and they said, well, the land outside my house is like, if I had two cars there, it would cause there'd be major soil erosion around there. And then that would have a major impact on the fields where I work and also some of the other fields around. And it could cause like long-term soil damage. So I really wouldn't want to have two cars. I'll just have one this year, please. And that got marked down as not looking into the future, but actually also just, you know, taking this short gain today. So your quant results are only as good as your question. And even then, you know, there's a paper that came out a couple of weeks ago where they compared self-reports of people, how much time they spend on Facebook, with actually how much time Facebook tracked they were on Facebook. And I think the correlation between self-reports and actual time was about 0.2. So that's been not much of a correlation at all. So it's kind of garbage in, garbage out sometimes. And so what does that mean? And how can we deal with that? Well, the it means that, like, it doesn't mean that that quantitative work isn't useful, but it's knowing the time and place, and it works when you've really got clear answers, questions you want answered, and you kind of have an idea what your answer is. And so much when we're dealing with software, we don't know what the software is going to be like in 5 years' time. And that's why, personally, I'm kind of enthusiastic for bringing in qualitative results, and I think they can really inform the design in that way. But to get onto your specific question, so you're right that I think it can be super hard to do qualitative stuff, because you can kind of do your, I mean, anybody can do an interview, can't you? I mean, you just go ask someone some questions, go and see what someone's doing, maybe video record somebody using an app. You can do that. And then how do you get from that to like sort of feel, yeah, you know, that actually photographs are social or whatever like that. And there's a whole bunch of like intermediate steps, I think, that you need to kind of go through. But one of the kind of core kind of ones I always rely on a lot is just sort of writing down lists of kind of codes almost. So when you kind of, you've got a bit of data, I often would just kind of read the data and I'll say, well, what's this idea? Well, I think that maybe one idea is that people like showing photographs to their friends. They don't like slide presentations or da da da. And I might make a kind of like a list of these kind of codes like this. And I often put them together in what are called spider diagrams, where you kind of try and draw lines between them. Kind of looks a bit kind of mad sometimes. And so I think that's kind of one of the core things in the analytic steps, is just to kind of keep going over and over again what things you think are interesting and the connections between them. And obviously that's kind of quite complex, but a very simple way of doing it, just writing down words that come out of what you've done in terms of your data and drawing kind of lines between them.
If you do qualitative research to inform the design of a product in industry versus doing qualitative research for a research paper, how does the reporting or the analysis differ in there? Because I don't imagine that in a company, for example, if you do research to inform a product, I don't imagine that you go and write a full-blown ethnography or a full-blown 10-20-page research paper-style report. So how do people communicate, or how have you communicated or observed this happening in industry?
Yeah, I mean, the first thing that's kind of radically different in industry is the lack of time. You know, lots of things in life are like exchanges between money and time, between resources and time in different ways. And sometimes you get one of other and you go back and forth. And I always say that, you know, one of the problems with academia is we sometimes undervalue time and we overvalue money. That, you know, I think there's kind of those kind of can be really serious problems in industry. So people just don't have the time. And so that doesn't mean that they aren't interested in finding out what's right and they aren't interested in the insights, but they have to be kind of boiled down to a point where they can be really kind of communicated and help in the decision-making process. So it varies from organization to organization, of course, but organizations are oral cultures. The place where they happen is in talk. That's not necessarily the case in academic research, but organizations are oral cultures. So slideware is kind of the thing you'll see getting swapped around. So people send their slides around. That's why I always thought it was kind of hilarious, this argument that you should make a slide presentation so that you can just, you know, you need to see the presentation to get the slide, get the understanding of it. In organizations, you need to be able to send someone a slide deck and they can understand it without having you there. Whenever I do slides, I always try and make the slides stand alone. So, but yeah, that's the kind of way you do it, through talking to people.
That's a great insight, actually. We don't realize that in academia, even in like the most basic textbooks, which are oriented towards students who might go work in industry, they don't tell you how things are done in industry necessarily, because they're written by professors and academics who concentrate on how things are done in research, very rigorous, very proper. So that's what you study usually. But I will
There's actually one book that I always recommend what I usually say to people is, if you're ever in a company and something happens and you don't understand why it happens, there's a book called The Ropes to Skip and The Ropes to Take. Hmm. And it's basically a kind of introduction to organizational life by this organizational sociologist. It's really fun because it's actually half written as fiction. I always really recommend people to get this book because it's one of the best explanations. If you don't believe me, look at the reviews of this book on Amazon, because there's like lots of reviews. People are like, this is the only book I ever actually read in my university years it was any use. And I always give this book to students because, you know, we have to be able to negotiate and manage organizations, and this book is so full of great lessons.
So for someone who's interested in doing qualitative research, especially to inform design work, and especially for software and electronic products, and you may think of this from the perspective of a student, like a master's student, for example, who has 1 or 2 years that they can use to learn a particular skill or a particular behavior, what would be some attributes, a skill, belief, habit, or behavior, for example, that is an absolute must-have if you're going to create value through qualitative research? And what would be a belief, habit, or behavior that would set someone up for failure?
I think it's just realizing, of course, that different, you need different people in a development process, and not everybody can do everything. And so one of the things, that I'm not a believer that everyone should be able to be asked to do everything. And so particularly there's many people in the development process who, you know, they're not really great with people, right? We kind of know this. And I think that's cool. I think we need people who can really drill down on topics and not be distracted and kind of have skills in that department. But then on the other hand, I think you also need people who really like other people and like working out what's motivating them. And so I think that's one of the skills that you really need to do good quality of research, is kind of be interested in what makes people tick and what motivates them, what frustrates them, how they see the world, how it differs from your view of the world, and kind of being able to do that in a non-judgmental way. And that's kind of hard, I think, and not everyone most people can do it, I think, because we're all human beings, but having some kind of analytic empathy is, like, if you want to do really, really good qualitative work, is kind of essential. I think that's that thing, just trying to understand the other person's point of view in sometimes in very excruciating detail, right? So sometimes it's not just like a big, oh, what drives you as a person, which is kind of one thing, but it can be a little bit like, why did you click on this here and not there? Or why did you put the app down at this point? And those things are interesting because often they're not like immediately apparent to the person. They come from some more like, you know, like you can just be confused, you can be lost, you can just kind of get bored. One of the big driving things in mobile app use is people get bored and they just stop using things and they get bored. And you've got to be kind of interested in when they do and when they don't, and when that does happen, to kind of get to the roots of that.
So a focus on people is a must. And then conversely, what would be something not to do or not to have, not to believe?
That's a kind of, and I think just about anything can, you know, you kind of, there's a, the, you know, that there's lots of situations where what you need is that person who is different from everyone else. And that's like that. There's so many cases where I've been working on something and it's been kind of saved by the person who 99% of the time was kind of a pain, and then that 1% that they gave. So that's the thing, is like, you know, a strength in one situation can be a weakness in the other. So I'm always, you have to be a little bit careful with culling out things and saying, oh, that's not what you should do, because it can turn out in a different situation to be kind of really, you know, really helpful. I think that like, Yeah, one thing that, like, I mean, of course, it kind of comes back to the same thing. It's like some people can be a bit condescending to others. That's just kind of just the way some things are. And that's a shitty thing to have anyway, but it, particularly if you're doing kind of this sort of stuff, it can be really, really bad. And so I think it's like never guess that, never know what you know what's going on in someone else's life. Like, I remember I was in an elevator in a doctor's surgery here a couple of years back. And then there's this guy in the elevator, and he just kind of went, fuck, and swore. And then basically the kind of doors opened and he walked out and the doors closed. And I was kind of, you know, some of the people in the lift, and I was like, gee, what's he in that guy? And my daughter who was there, and she just turned to me and said, well, Dad, you don't know what went on in that guy's life today, you know? I was just like, yeah, he was drunk. And she's like, no, you don't know what's going on in his life. And so who are you to say, you know? And I think that was kind of, like, yeah, okay, you're right, actually. Who am I to say what's going on in someone else's life?
That's a very profound insight, not to judge people's motivations, I guess. And when I first heard of this this idea, this insight, it was in the I don't remember where I heard the story, but it was a story where I think it was a very prominent politician, maybe Bill Clinton or someone, who was articulating this insight about, you don't know what's going on in someone's life, so you don't judge them based on very limited observation. And it's very cool to hear the same coming from your daughter. How old is she?
She's 10 now, actually. She's a bit younger then, actually. So it was, I mean, of course, the flip side is we're human beings, aren't we? We sort of, we do quite a bit of these judgments.
Yeah, really cool. So you mentioned that in these projects that you're involved in, not everyone can do everything, so you need a team of people, and diverse teams seem to win the day. Could you walk us through a real and recent project where you kind of start with an idea or design challenge and then you get significant results, which could be a research paper, it could be a commercial product, it could be a project that gets press or a portfolio piece that gets someone a job? And could you focus particularly on team composition? Who's in the team? Who's doing what? How does that work?
Yeah, so like some of the recent work we've done, which I think has been kind of fun, has been around smart voice agents. So kind of Alexa and Google Home and these kind of systems, and you know, they've got kind of quite popular. They're quite frustrating, as anyone's got one at home will know. One of the kind of problems, I mean, like when we're interacting in whether we're face to face or even on a kind of video call, is we don't just have access to their voice. We have access to people's bodies and their eyes where they're looking. So one of the kind of things we were kind of quite interested in was a lot of these speech agents, they actually have cameras in them, but they don't do very much with the cameras. And we thought, could you actually bring in like an understanding of how the how people are looking into designing these systems? So we kind of, this was their kind of idea, and we ended up working and built a system that we called Tama, which is a little robot, very, very simple. It's kind of inside it is basically got a Google Home, and then it's got two little lights on the top, and it basically, they can look at the eyes. And so that means it can look at you, and then also it has cameras that can detect when you're looking at it. And so we built the system, and rather than what's called a wake word, which is something like Alexa or one of these kind of wake words, rather than doing that, you look at the device and it looks back at you, and then you can kind of ask it if you want it to do something. So so that was kind of interesting, and that was fun. I think the project there, because we needed a bunch of different people, we needed to understand a bit about social interaction, to understand how we can build something that actually did eye gaze which is quite a tricky thing to do. And we got it wrong, by the way. We made a lot of mistakes, and that's why it's research, actually. Secondly, we needed hardware designers. We needed industrial designers. We actually worked with a research group in Japan who have built different robots in different ways. We needed a PhD student who worked on running an experiment where we looked to try and understand where it worked and where it didn't work, you know, what we would respond to and what we wouldn't respond to. I think that was one of those kind of pieces we got, kind of quite a nice bit of research out, I think, which was kind of, and just now we've got a bit of industrial interest. Just, I'm going to leave it. I'm not going to say much more than that in the system. Because I think people are realizing that that these systems are kind of getting to the edge of what they can really do in terms of usefulness. And so people are looking around to see what more you could add to them. So I think that was kind of a nice project, and certainly one that we needed social scientists, we needed hardware developers, industrial designers, software engineers, and user researchers all kind of working together.
So what is a resource, which can be a book, but also maybe a paper, a video, an online course, anything, that you recommend to your students and colleagues most frequently? And what is a resource that has influenced your work the most?
So I was thinking a little bit about this kind of question, and it's an interesting one. Because it depends what you want to do, right? And I think for doing qualitative research, I think it's good actually to have read a couple of qualitative research examples, right? Mm-hmm. And so the one I always recommend to people is a book called Sidewalk, mm-hmm. which is about a study of an American street and particularly the homeless people on that street. And I think that's I always think this, collecting really good examples of people doing social research, even if it's nothing to do with technology, is kind of really, really useful. And you can, there's kind of new ones, lots of different ones come out that I think they're really nice. But I always kind of suggest people to look at that one because it's a really, really beautifully written as well. And in terms of I think that I think one of the things when you're doing mobile design, I think that the looking at other apps is almost more useful, and learning from that. And I think that I'm not sure if I'd actually recommend one particular kind of resource. I'm sure you've got some kind of texts that you use in your course. I would just sort of say it's kind of important to kind of use a lot of apps and look at them and try and use them themselves. And that's often a bit more useful.
That's really good advice. What is some bad advice that you hear in your profession or area of expertise?
The thing is that people are sometimes thought that they have to be a master of everything. And I think it's okay to specialize a little bit and know what you want to do. That's kind of one thing. But also I think I also sort of say to people, really try and like technology. And this sounds like it's kind of strange thing, but I think sometimes there's a certain tendency to kind of want to be a bit too cool for school and not like technology and sometimes in our field. And I think I remember I worked with a guy who said that he would never hire anybody if they had the default background in their computer. And I think that's a horrible and bad recruitment technique. I wouldn't recommend it to anybody, but it always just made me think a little bit about that if someone isn't caring about their environment enough to change their default background, they're not caring about the thing they should be caring about, which is the materials that we work with. And you know what? You don't have to do this job. You really don't like those materials. You can go somewhere else and do something else. And you should, because but it doesn't mean you can be you should be uncritical. It doesn't mean that you should sort of be like an enthusiast and always on the internet or whatever. But you've got to kind of, I think, have some interest in those materials, or it's going to kind of stop you. Now everybody's checking to see if they've got the default background on the computer or not. It's like, yeah.
So you have to be interested in this domain and technology in your work. I guess you can't sort of separate it out as a just purely professional activity completely from all of the other aspects of your life. That's what I'm sort of one of the interpretations that I have from what you said. So that makes me curious, other than your work, where obviously you are very productive, you're an established scholar. What else do you spend your time on the most?
So I think there's lots of fun things people do that I do, kind of in my family, and I actually I like cycling and I like kind of doing hiking and things like that. But I think your point is I think this is kind of really important one, which is that I think you've been talking a little bit about the trade-offs between money and time. And one lesson I learned in Sweden was that it's really good to have time where you're not doing work and you keep that away from your work. And that can actually make your work better if you're interested in that, but it also just makes you a better human being. So I think my point would be just to list my interests, which maybe isn't so interesting for your audience, but more just this kind of importance of having bits of your life that you keep separate. There's also you need a little bit of spice to enrich the other things in your life, otherwise you can be kind of a bit boring.
Yeah, that's a skill that I'm trying to develop myself also, since I've also recently started living in Scandinavia relatively recently, and coming from another culture, in my case from Turkey, it's different. The kind of work-life balance or the work-life distribution, let's say. So it's a skill that I'm trying to learn. I'm not super successful at it these days, which makes me curious. So I'm going to go back to your career. In your career, has there been a failure or apparent failure that later set you up for success? Do you have a favorite failure in your career, for example?
I think that the one case, I think it's an interesting one, is so I've had lots of job interviews where I didn't get the job. And I don't think people talk much about that, right? Because it's somehow this idea that you kind of get the all these really successful people get kind of obviously hired straight away, or they get all these different job offers. And of course, even the most amazing people got job interviews and didn't get hired. And more mundane kind of practitioners like myself collect them maybe to an extreme. And I also think there's good things about that, actually, because there's no better way to find out about a company than to be interviewed by them. And also to discover maybe the kind of good and bad sides of them, because you actually get to sit down with the people from that company and talk to them for an hour at a time, or longer sometimes. I interviewed years back. I interviewed to be on the Microsoft smartphone team. This was way before the iPhone, when they were the probably in the West anyway. They were the most successful kind of smartphone manufacturer. Even before it was called Windows Mobile, it was called Snapdragon when I interviewed. And I didn't get the job, actually, but that was maybe a blessing, because that wasn't a project that was going places. But there were interesting people. I mean, I think the lesson I learned from that interview was I actually was kind of really interested in I got interviewed because I'd done quite a bit of work on Japanese cell phones. And at that time, they, for various reasons, were kind of leading the world. And so they were kind of interested a little bit in bringing in some insights from Japan into the Western smartphone market or cell phone market. And then I got asked a really basic question about card sorting, which is a way that you organize things in menus and user interfaces. And I kind of just blanked and couldn't answer this super basic HCI method kind of question. And I kind of remember the person was like, and it was kind of like, this is all interesting, you can talk about this, but you can't do this basic thing. And I didn't get the job, but I learned a lot, and it was nice to talk to people anyway and get a bit of insight into what they were doing.
Yeah, that's really cool. So every failure in a way makes you better. That's all of the intelligent and semi-intelligent questions that I have. But before I conclude, is there a question that I should be asking you that I've neglected?
I imagine your students are kind of one question that they always would want answered would be how to get a job. Getting that first job can just kind of seem really, really hard. And if I'm to answer the question, which I guess is kind of, I should really do if I'm going to ask, pose the question to myself, which is that I always kind of say try and get involved as much as possible with things. So there's a whole bunch of different events, meetups and what have you that happen all the time. And that if you can just meet somebody and meet people at things, that can really help you. And actually hanging around is actually like gets halfway to getting a job anywhere.
I can definitely confirm that from thinking back about my own sort of career and the jobs that I've held. Pretty much every successful job that I've acquired, it was through personal questions, personal connections. I remember my first job, the way that I got it was that I was sitting in a cafe with my friend who recently got into a company. We graduated at the same time and he got the job and he described to me his job. He was very enthusiastic about it. He liked the company and his job very much. And I told him, wow, that sounds really good. Can you get me a job in there as well? And the next week I interviewed and 2 weeks later I started the job. So it's true that having people in focus, both in terms of both design as a philosophy, as a sort of core value as a designer, and but also in terms of how you conduct your career, I think that's a sound thing to have in mind. Those then are all of my questions, Professor Barry Brown. Thank you very much for this interview. We have certainly learned a lot from you, and I do hope to have you back because I don't think I've had enough of your wisdom yet.
Well, that's one way to put that. But thanks for your kind questions and being generous with your time as well. Thanks.